all so much for joining us again this week for our third Miami Global Brain Tumor Symposium. Very excited to have everybody here for our third week. First 2 weeks were so successful. Once again, my name is Michael Ivan. I'm one of the brain tumor and skull-based specialists here at University of Miami, and I'm joined today by my co-directors, Dr. Komotar, director of the brain tumor program, and Dr. Morcos, director of the skull-based and vascular program here at Miami. Their contact info is noted here. Just to remind you all, if you don't know already, to get updates or information about our symposiums, you can follow us at Brain Miami on Twitter. All of the presentations will be uploaded to YouTube after, as we already have the first 2 weeks up there. You could also register on our neurosurgery website at neurosurgery.med.edu. Or you could follow us, either the University of Miami Neurosurgery on Twitter, Instagram, or my own. Before we start this week, just a little teaser for next week. We'll be excited to introduce Dr. Defoe, really making this an international and global symposium. He'll be joining us late night from France for our 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So please stay tuned for more information. Well, let's talk about this week. First, I just want to introduce this week's panelists. They've been so gracious to join us this evening. They are kind of junior and associate professors from across the country who specialize in anterior skull base tumors, like what we'll be talking about today. We have Dr. Hardesty coming from Ohio State, who's a brain tumor and skull base specialist. We have Dr. Rutkowski, who is my colleague from UCSF, who is now assistant professor at Medical College of Georgia, focusing on open and endoscopic skull base. Dr. Recinos, director of skull base fellowship at Cleveland Clinic. Dr. Hanft, director of minimally invasive skull base at Rutgers. And Dr. Sivakumar, who's the director of neurovascular neurosurgery and a skull base and minimally invasive surgeon at the Pacific Neuroscience Institute. So thank you all. They'll be helping answer the questions from the audience today, and they have a few case presentations at the end for us to discuss if time allows. And let's get to the keynote speaker for this week, Dr. Schwartz. It's his birthday tonight, so extra special thanks to him for joining us. Dr. Schwartz is a professor of neurosurgery and director of the Surgical Neuro-Oncology, Epilepsy, and Pituitary Program at Cornell Medical College and New York Presbyterian Hospital. He's really devoted his career to improving and pursuing minimally invasive operative techniques, and probably has one of the longest series to talk about that, which is why today's presentation is so apropos for his title. He received his undergraduate and medical degrees from Harvard, did his residency at Columbia, spent a year in fellowship at Yale, and was a recipient of the prestigious Van Wagenen and Van Homburg fellowships. He's director of the Institute for Minimally Invasive Skull Base and Pituitary Program at Cornell, and additionally is director of the Epilepsy Research Lab, which has been funded by multiple NIH grants throughout the years, really showing off how much of a well-rounded physician scientist he is. So so much thanks for him to giving up his night on his birthday here tonight to let us know about pituitary and endoscopic surgery and inform the world. Thank you, Dr. Schwartz.
It's a pleasure to spend my birthday. This is the biggest birthday party I've ever had, right? There's 275 people at my party, so thank you all. My wife got me this hat that says 55 never looks so good. So I hope you all agree. Anyway, thank you, Jacques. Thank you, Rick, Michael, for inviting me to give this talk. It's really a pleasure to get a chance to talk about my experience with endonasal surgery. And I'm going to talk uniquely about pituitary adenomas in this talk and leave some of the more extended stuff for other discussions. So let me go into presentation mode. Perfect. So just a quick overview. I'm going to talk a little bit about technique. I'm going to talk about reoperations, cellular hematomas, intraoperative MRI versus endoscopy, long-term outcomes, the role of radiation therapy I'm going to touch on, the neurosurgical learning curve, and then a little bit about transfemoral surgery in the age of COVID. So I want to hit a bunch of different topics to keep people's interests, and I'll move quickly through all of those. These are some papers that we've published on those topics that have come out of my lab in the last couple of years. I just want to give special thanks to Ian Yunus, Mina Gurgis, Hazem Negum, Christian Sonaru, people who helped me with a lot of these papers. So at Cornell New York Presbyterian Hospital, we started this Institute for Minimally Invasive Skull-Based and Pituitary Surgery with myself and Dr. Vijay Anand, who was my ENT colleague. And since then, the ENT and neurosurgery groups have expanded and have other people helping. So the first thing to touch on is, how important is it to be an expert and to get experience in pituitary tumors, and how does that impact your long-term outcomes? So we already know that creating a center of excellence is very important in pituitary tumors. There are papers out there showing that outcomes really are better if you go to a surgeon who does a lot of pituitary tumors, and that will bear itself out. And in our center, I work very closely with an endocrinologist, and obviously pituitary tumors, the endocrinology, the medicine of these tumors is so critically important, and you as a neurosurgeon need to have that understanding, but you also need a strong partnership with a great endocrinologist, and we have a great endocrinologist in Dr. Dobry. So I've done about 1,500 cases at this point, endonasal endoscopic cases. About half of them are endocrine related, and this is the breakdown, and I'm going to talk about non-functional and functional adenomas. And the numbers really aren't that important, except I will be talking about the learning curve, and I think that does bring the numbers into it. We are a uniquely endoscopic center. The first time I used an endoscope, I never used a microscope again. It was like a love at first sight. We did our first case in December of 2003. I never looked back. This is what the OR looks like. It's a pretty standard setup that we have, and this is what surgery looks like. And again, this is pretty standard for most centers. We were lucky enough to publish this book, and we have some other ones coming out that talk a bit about our technique and our thought process. So pituitary tumors are common. You know, these are tumors that all neurosurgeons see. And so it's important for us to really take control of these tumors. It's a tumor that we tend to manage on our own for the most part with an endocrinologist. And I tell my patients when I give my welcoming spiel that these tumors come in two flavors. And those are the hormone producing ones and the non-hormone producing ones. And I'm not going to go into great detail about the endocrinology of them, but most of the non-hormone producing ones are macroadenomas. They compress the chiasm and they cause visual loss. And this really, what I want to get the sense across is this is our disease. Like we own pituitary tumors. You know, it's part of our tradition and we should be proud of that. And it's a fun disease. You know, these patients can walk into your office, you can take one look at them and you know exactly what diagnosis they have. And the visual loss is really a wonderful thing to work with, because often patients come in with visual loss and when they leave, their vision is better, you know, and what a great gift to be able to take a patient who's going blind and to restore their sight. You know, what a wonderful thing and privilege to be able to do that. We did this study showing that ironically, a lot of our elderly patients come to us with cataract surgery because their ophthalmologists have misdiagnosed their visual loss. And actually the prevalence of cataract surgery in patients, elderly patients with macroadenomas, is about 2.5 times the national average. You have to be careful with that, that diagnosis and working those patients up carefully. So what are our surgical objectives? Well, for non-hormone producing tumors, they're generally macroadenomas. We want to relieve mass effect. We want to go for a gross total resection if we can. The goal is to remove all suprasellar tumor and all tumor, at least in the medial cavernous sinus. Leaving residual in the lateral cavernous sinus is okay, right? That we have Gamma Knife, we have a great treatment for that if we have to. So we definitely don't want to cause a cranial neuropathy to chase tumor in the lateral cavernous sinus. If you can get it out easily, that's great, but we don't want to be hurting our patients, and we don't want to leave residual tumor adjacent to the optic nerves, because if they do need radiation, we don't want to radiate the optic nerves. For microadenomas, the goal is to stop endocrine hyperactivity. And to do that, you have to get a gross total resection. And that's really the key. If you want to be a little more aggressive in the cavernous sinus for those patients, that's okay if you think you can get a hormonal cure, but keep in mind that SRS does work for hormone-producing tumors as well. So the key to surgery is finding the pseudocapsule. That's really what it's all about. I'm going to show you examples of that, talk to you about that. It's the best way to know that the entire tumor is removed, the neuronal gland is preserved. For microadenomas, you want to take your tumors out en bloc and remove some of the adjacent dura if it's next to the dura. And for macroadenomas, it's important to use extended approaches if you need to. You can remove the tuberculum, open the anterior cavernous sinus. And then the order of removing it, we all learn from Ed Laws, bottom and then sides. And I'll show examples. So Ed Oldfield really changed a lot of our thinking about these tumors, these microadenomas, showing that there's a pseudocapsule and you want to try to take these tumors out en bloc to cure, particularly patients with Cushing's disease. But the same can be true for acromegaly and prolactinomas as well. And some great work with Ed Law showing invasion of the adjacent dura related to tumors based on size. And the bigger the hormone-producing tumors are, the more likely they're going to invade the adjacent cavernous sinus wall and the dura. And the same thing is true with Cushing's disease by this paper by Russ Lonser and Ed Oldfield, basically showing that the bigger the tumor is, the more likely it's going to invade the adjacent dura. So here's some technical things. I learned, again, this was actually through John Jane telling me what Ed Oldfield did and seeing the videos of him using an 11 blade. So I started using an 11 blade, even with an endoscope, and opening up the pituitary to get down to that pseudocapsule. And often you have to cut through a little bit of normal pituitary gland to get to the pseudocapsule. And then using very gentle bimanual surgery with traction and countertraction, the goal is to try to get the tumor out without having it explode in front of you. And it took me years to learn how to do this. You can see the normal gland on the outside and the pituitary tumor and its pseudocapsule being very carefully and gently teased away to be removed en bloc from the normal pituitary gland. This other case of Cushing's a little more difficult. You can see the tumor in the middle and it's buried, right? So I'm looking at this, I'm saying, all right, I know where I need to go. I need to go in the middle and I got to go down a couple of millimeters to get to this tumor. And there's not a lot of pressure in the cella, as you can see when we open up the dura. And you know, these cases seem like they're going to be easy and that you just let the resident do these cases, but these cases are actually some of the hardest cases that we do if you really want to do an en bloc removal. It is technically very challenging. And I'll talk about that when it comes to the learning curve. But you see here, we took out a bit of the pituitary gland and you can remove some of it and keep the gland functioning as long as the stalk is communicating with the majority of the gland on either side and the vasculature is preserved. And we can very carefully dissect this tumor and try to find that pseudocapsule and peel it down. Often it's like an onion. You have to get down right to the capsule. And even if you take a little bit of normal gland around it to make sure you get the whole tumor out, that's fine as long as you know you're leaving enough tumor to preserve pituitary function. So that's a pseudocapsule removal. And you can see the histology showing that pseudocapsule in the post-op scan. For small tumors like that, I try to preserve the mucosa within the sphenoid and then just replace the mucosa. You can actually just, if you can, spread it aside and then put it back together and try to keep it together. For macroadenomas, the key is to remove some of the planum and some of the tuberculum really is more important than that. And I use my navigation to try to see how much of that tuberculum I'm going to remove. And if I have to take a little planum, I'll take that as well. And if I have to open up the cavernous sinus, I'll do that as well. So here we're doing a standard approach, opening up the dura. I like to do it in a cruciate fashion. I like to use a scissors when I open it. And then I try to dissect the dura away from the tumor so I can try to find that normal pituitary gland and try to find that plane. And I do that circumferentially around the tumor first, and then I internally debulk the tumor because it can be very hard to find the pseudocapsule with a big mass. But once you've debulked the bottom, you can see we can find that pseudocapsule even with a big tumor. You can see the normal pituitary gland. We use gentle bimanual dissection to come around the pituitary tumor and get the whole thing out more or less en bloc. And that's how you know that you've preserved the normal gland, you've removed the whole tumor. Now, in this video, I'm showing you a closure where I'm using some gel foam and some flow seal and some surgicel and then a nasal septal flap, which we had harvested beforehand, even though there was no CSF leak. We harvested because we thought there might be a CSF leak. You can use a lumbar drain in big tumors because often the arachnoid will herniate down. And if you open up the lumbar drain, you can push it back. I like to take just a cottonoid and elevate the arachnoid with a cottonoid if I feel like I've left some tumor behind. And here we're using fat, although I've kind of moved away from fat. So here's some tips for macroadenomas. Harvest the flap. If you think there's a high risk of CSF leak, tumor's bigger than 3 centimeters, consider a lumbar drain if there's a high risk of CSF leak, but I'm using lumbar drains less and less often. We're using it now with tumors bigger than 4 centimeters. You can use fat, it absolutely works. I'm trying to move away from making separate incisions on people's bodies to really make these minimally invasive. So we often use Alamax as an inlay, put a flap on top of that, even if there's a leak. And then the key is to avoid a post-op hematoma. Some of these big macroadenomas have a high risk of post-op hematoma. So I'll use a bipolar, try to shrink the cavity a little bit, try to stop the bleeding, profuse irrigation, and then use surgicel rather than gel foam and flow seal because it will not expand as much afterwards because it's that post-op expansion when there's late bleeding that can cause compression of the chiasm. And here's just a big tumor that sort of puts it all together. There's suprasellar extent, there's clival extent, there's cavernous sinus extent. You can see the carotid arteries are encased, the bone's really been eroded. So here we harvest the vascularized nasal septal flap. We start our opening, take off the bone in the middle with a carotid. And it's important to make a very wide sphenoidotomy so you can see everything you need to see. If you're gonna go into the cavernous sinus, you have to use a Doppler, find out exactly where those carotids are, remove the bone over the carotid so that you can lateralize them if you have to, and work from medial to lateral and sometimes around them. The arachnoid's coming down here. We're elevating and moving the arachnoid out of the way so we can work laterally on either side. And then the key here is we now have to go inferiorly down to the clivus. So we have to open up the basal pharyngeal fascia. So we're gonna open up working between the eustachian tubes inferiorly all the way down into the base of the clivus. And you see we're gonna open up a little more of the basal pharyngeal fascia just behind the eustachian tube. And then with an angled endoscope, an angled curettes, you'll see the petrous carotid artery that is encased in tumor. So we can work around the carotid and remove all the tumor there. And then I just filled this with Flow Seal in this case because it was such a big, worrisome, bloody cavity, and then put a nasal septal flap. You can see postoperatively, everything has been removed down to the carotids, to the base of the clivus. So what about reoperations? For residual, often I'll see patients who have not had a complete resection. We looked at our experience. This young girl and her family gave us permission to use her films. This is her at age 9, this is her at age 11. She has gigantism. And she had a previous endoscopic surgery, but they didn't really do a transplanum, transtuberculum approach. So they left suprasellar tumor behind, above. So we went in for a reoperation. You can see the mucosa is pretty well healed. So the first thing we want to do is take down the closure that they did and expand the opening. So we gave intrathecal fluorescein in this case. And you can see we're opening above the cella and exposing the dura of the tuberculum, because we need to go suprasellar in this operation. You can see the optic chiasm, the arachnoid, and all the residual tumor. But when you do an extended approach and you open up the tuberculum, everything is right in front of you. So it doesn't become as difficult a case. If you're worried about CSF leak, you might be scared to do this kind of an opening. But if you're comfortable with closing large defects like this, then this becomes a very easy approach to do and gives you great exposure. So we're working underneath the optic nerve, cauterizing, cutting, and you can see we're staring right at the residual tumor. And by doing that additional extended approach, it makes the case much easier. So I'm gonna move forward in the interest of time. We just did a gasket seal closure here, and she was cured of her gigantism. Her growth hormone came back to a normal level. So I was really pleased with that, that outcome. Cavernous sinus, we can go into the medial cavernous sinus. If the tumor is soft, we can follow it out into the lateral cavernous sinus. This is a recurrent tumor that had a tumor in the cavernous sinus. So we're gonna show you removing the bone over the carotid artery and over the cella. Here we're taking the bone over the cella, and then we'll go lateral and remove the bone over the cavernous sinus. So, you know, the carotid artery gets pushed laterally. You can expose the entire cavernous sinus dura, and we use the Doppler to find the carotid, and then we know where it's safe to open. So once we know where the carotid is, we know we can open everything medial to that, and then go much more lateral than you would think just based on the conception of what the cavernous sinus is. You can see we're opening the dura all the way over because the carotid has been pushed laterally, and then we can get in and remove residual tumor. This was another patient with acromegaly. You can tell by the white flakiness of the tumor. And it's important to have angled endoscopes, angled instruments, angled suctions in order to work in all the corners to make sure you get out all of the tumor from all the different compartments of the cavernous sinus, and then finish off with some Flow Seal and gel foam. I'll use Flow Seal and gel foam in the cavernous sinus because I'm not worried about expansion compressing the optic nerves. And this is post-op. So what are our short-term results? I'm going to talk about short-term results before I talk about long-term results. Well, we cure patients with tumors about 80% of the time, actually. So this was initial short-term results in the early endoscopic results. Apton DeBee wrote this up, looking at cure rates and gross total resection rates. The first was gross total resection. This is overall hormone cure is about 80%. And even if you divide it up based on ACTH, growth hormone, and prolactin, it's still about 80% for all of the different hormone subtypes. What are the things that correlate with not curing patients? Well, if you get a gross total resection, you're more likely to cure them. If the patients don't have supracellular extension, you're more likely to cure them. If you have a microadenoma, you're more likely to cure them. And if there's no cavernous sinus invasion, you're more likely to cure them. So things that we are well accepted. Sorry, someone's ringing my doorbell or calling my phone. I apologize about that. If we look at non-hormone producing tumors, we like to classify them volumetrically. Previously, they've been classified mostly greater than 3 centimeters, greater than 4 centimeters. We did a lot of work showing that your extent of resection, what's most important is actually 10 cubic centimeters. And if your tumor is greater than 10 cubic centimeters, that's where you start to decrease your extent of resection and where you start to get more complications. So we sort of mapped out based on diameters and volumes and cavernous sinus invasion, all of our tumors. And Christoph Hofstetter did this great work showing that 10 cubic centimeters was kind of that sweet spot of when you start to decrease your extent of resection. And then Omar Chohan also looked at our non-hormone producing tumors, things that correlated with subtotal resection, again, preoperative volume, NOSP grade, and then growth above the planum was not quite significant. And here's just the results of the medial to lateral. So if you're a little more conservative and don't be too aggressive in the cavernous sinus, these were our results for cavernous sinus adenomas. And what I want to highlight is that 6 of our patients had preoperative cranial neuropathies, and all 6 were improved after surgery, and none were deteriorated. So you know, again, you can be aggressive, but you don't have to be too aggressive. As long as the tumor's soft, you can go in the cavernous sinus. And if it's very firm and fibrous, I would leave it for radiosurgery. What about normal pituitary function? This actually is not my work. This was Ed Laws. I thought this was a great paper where they looked at some patients who had normal endocrine function preoperatively and how many lost function, only about 6%. And then they looked at those patients who had impaired function preoperatively. How many got it better? Well, not that many, only about 7%. Recovered their lost pituitary function. So if a patient comes to you with poor pituitary function from a large non-hormone producing tumor, I tell them, you know what, I'm not sure you're going to get it all back or any of it back. We'll try. But hopefully we won't make you any worse and we'll get that tumor out. I have to show this. Rick Komotar had a meta-analysis factory with Bob Stark and Dan Raper, and I was lucky enough to benefit from that. And he did this interesting study that I love, even though it was a meta-analysis review of the literature, which is problematic in most of them when they compare different approaches, because often there's a selection bias, right? So the craniotomies for some tumors, they choose bigger tumors, the endonasal choose smaller tumors. So this was a study that only looked at macroadenomas. So these are only for giant tumors greater than 4 centimeters. So we're comparing apples with apples. And you compare endonasal surgery with open transcranial surgery with transphenoidal microscopic surgery, and we found that gross total resection was really dramatically higher for endonasal endoscopic surgery. And visual outcome was also significantly better for endonasal endoscopic surgery. This is for these giant macroadenomas that I always had been taught had to be done through a craniotomy or a combined approach. Purely endonasal gives you better outcome. And even complications were lower, including CSF leak, lower when you do it through an endonasal approach than, believe it or not, through a craniotomy. The only thing that was higher was sinusitis. We looked at, again, going back to reoperations, we looked at our series of reoperations and looked at this particular complication, which is cellar hematoma that I had described in the past. And we see this mainly in giant and big tumors. So for a series of 583 pituitary patients, the incidence of cellar hematoma that required reoperation was about 1.5%. There were 9 patients where they basically woke up, they had worse vision, they had a hematoma on their MRI, and we took them back. Now, when you take them back, clot evacuation improved their vision about 90% of the time. So it's very effective. So if there's any doubt and a patient has worsening vision, we just take them right back to the OR. But keep in mind, new post-op endocrine dysfunction was also very high. It was about 80%. A lot of these patients with post-op cellular hematomas, that hematoma damages their pituitary function. So that's one of the risks of it and why we try to avoid it. Obviously, length of stay was higher. And the things that correlated with the post-op hematoma were diameter greater than 3 centimeters, supracellular extension, tumor volume, cavernous sinus invasion, gonadotrophic histology, antiplatelet use, and elevated BMI. But the incidence in tumors greater than 3 centimeters was 5%. So 5% of those patients, you're going to have to go back, or at least we had to go back, which is why now I really am very, very careful with my hemostasis and my macroadenomas. And hopefully that's a tip I can give all of you guys. Really make sure you get good hemostasis and don't use anything that'll expand too much. I'm not going to say a lot about 3D endoscopy. We played with it for a while. We now mainly use a 4K 2D scope. The 3D scopes are great and some people love them, but I still love the resolution of the 4K 2D scope, and that's my go-to scope. And I think though, as the resolution of the 3D scopes and the representation becomes better, I think we will probably all eventually move in that direction, and we'll see how that technology evolves. What about intraoperative MRI? Just gonna say a few words. We actually published the first paper on combining intraoperative MRI and endoscopy, and we found that when we combined endoscopy with intraoperative MRI, this was back in 2004, we didn't have as much residual tumor as we as other intraoperative MRI papers did. And that led us to believe that the endoscope might be as good as intraoperative MRI. We recently published this paper, which was a meta-analysis of the literature, where we compared gross total resection rates where you're just using the endoscope was 69%. Using a microscope plus intraoperative MRI, basically the same. Using endoscope plus intraoperative MRI, basically the same. So we showed, in my opinion, that using the intraoperative MRI, if you're very facile with the endoscope and you're good with it and you are good with extended approaches and you know how to inspect the cavity, I don't think the intraoperative MRI adds that much. Certainly if you're using a microscope and you can't see around corners and you're doing a giant macroadenoma, the intraoperative MRI probably will help you dramatically. So that's my take on intraoperative MRI. I would rather have an endoscope with a 45 degree, a 30 degree scope than an intraoperative MRI just for pituitary adenomas. Now, there obviously are going to be some cases where it will still come in handy. And I don't want to completely set it aside, but I find the endoscope much more useful for the majority of cases. I'll leave it that way. So how do we manage patients who have a subtotal resection after surgery? What's the rate of recurrence? And should we irradiate those patients? So recurrence rates for pituitary adenomas after complete resection in the literature range anywhere from 7 to 33%. The rate varies depending on the type of tumor. It's highest in non-secreting tumors, and that's probably because those are the biggest ones that extend into the cavernous sinus and suprasellar. And regrowth of the tumor, if you don't take it all out, occurs in about 75% of the cases, and about half of those will be symptomatic. So we looked at long-term outcome because we've been doing this now for, I guess we started in 2003, so we're about 16 years or so, 17 years of doing endoscopic surgery. So we only took patients that we had greater than 5 years follow-up. So we tried to select those where we really could follow them. So we had got it down to about 190 patients with good greater than 5 year follow-up. And the follow-up after gross total resection, you can see is that dark bar is really, really small. And the recurrence that requires treatment, so in other words, not just a small recurrence we're going to ignore, is even smaller than that. And if you do a subtotal resection, the recurrence rate, as you can see, is about 20 to 25%. And I'll show you the actual numbers. So after gross total resection, probability of recurrence at 5 and 10 years was about 4 to 5%. The probability of requiring a treatment for recurrence was 0.8% and 1.6%. So really low, 10 years, 1.6% of these patients required a retreatment of some sort. So gross total resection is incredibly effective, you know, and these are some of the lowest rates reported. Now, here's an interesting finding. So of our subtotal resections, we only gave early post-op radiation therapy to 10%. So we have 90%, 57 patients, we did a subtotal resection and we just followed them. And we said, what's gonna happen if we do not irradiate them? And it turns out the probability of disease progression at 5 and 10 years was about 20 and 25%. And the probability of needing treatment was about 18 to 20%. So should everyone with residual tumor get immediate post-op SRS? I would argue no, because only 25% of those will actually progress. So you're treating 75% of your patients unnecessarily with SRS. This also was shown in another paper looking at need for treatment. And they say that residual tumors in this paper tended to grow more, but regrowth does not occur in all patients. They had regrowth only in 40%. So what predicts recurrence? Well, this is for gross total resection patients. If you have a high NOSP scale, you're more likely to recur. Size was almost significant, didn't quite reach significance. Ki-67 did though, you know, and that's very debatable about how we use Ki-67 in pituitary tumors. But if Ki-67 was greater than 3, which is what we considered high, they tended to grow back faster. And if it was a reoperation, a revision case, those tended to grow back faster. What about for subtotal resection? The ones that grew back the quickest were those that had either cavernous sinus residual, those that had the residual tumor was greater than 1 cubic centimeter, and revision cases. So what I would say is that if you have residual tumor, if it's in the cavernous sinus, it's greater than 1 centimeter, and if the Ki-67 is greater than 3%, I would just radiate those right away, because those are likely to recur pretty quickly. But if any of those criteria, or not all of them, are met, you could probably follow it. And if it's a reasonably reliable patient, if it recurs, then you can radiate it at that time. What about reoperation? How do we do? Well, we did a meta-analysis of the literature looking at endoscopic versus microscopic, showing that for reoperation, you're more likely to get a gross total resection using an endoscope than a microscope. You're more likely to get endocrine remission and more likely to get visual improvement. We looked at our own series of reoperations, and we found that we got a gross total resection almost 60% of the time, and a gross total or near total resection about 93% of the time. And the average extent of resection was 94% of the tumor. So reoperation is very, very effective if you have a recurrent tumor. Things that predict a lower rate of gross total resection are high NOSP grade, of course. Apologize for the phone or the doorbell, whatever's ringing. Post-op CSF leaks, we only had in one case. So, you know, if you're good at closing those defects, visual improvement, very high. Endocrine remission for reoperation, 80%. So even for hormone-producing tumors, reoperation is very, very effective. What about the learning curve? I want to spend, I'm almost done with my talk. I think I'm supposed to go 40 minutes. I'm at 34, so we'll be done by 40 minutes. So I want to talk a little bit about the learning curve. So we recently published this paper. We basically looked at 1,000 consecutive patients, and we skipped the first 200 cases, right? And a lot of people talk about the initial learning curve and how steep it is. And we wanted to say, all right, forget the initial learning curve. We know all about that. It takes a certain number of cases to get good at what you do. And that's most of the literature. It says, when am I an expert? Well, you got to do 200 cases. You got to do 100 cases. You got to do a certain amount. But what happens at the tail end of the learning curve? What happens after you've done 700 cases? Do you still improve after that? And so this is the standard learning curve. Phase one is kind of the beginner. Phase two is that steep learning curve. And then phase three, the question is, what happens there? Do you attempt more difficult cases and therefore the learning curve goes down? Do you plateau, meaning that you're a master and you just sort of get the same results? Or do you constantly get better and better? And is there a persistent acquisition of complex skills over time? So when we compared the first 500 to the second 500, we found that we got better even after 700 cases. So for everything, so for pituitary adenomas, my rate of gross total resection, even though it was 67% in the first 500, it was 75% in the second 500. And for meningiomas, craniopharyngiomas, chordomas, everything got better. So there's persistent improvement even after 700 cases, and the tail end of the learning curve is not flat. It just keeps going up and up and up. If you look at hormonal cure rates, and I want the second of these bars shows you when you combine them all together, my results for the first 500 were good. They were 83% cure rate. But for the second 500, it went up to 89%. And that was true for all of them. Prolactinomas, growth hormone, ACTH, they weren't significant for those. But when you put them all together, they were. So what does that mean? It means that baseline cure rates are high when you're a good surgeon. But it turns out if you're even better, you can get those rates even higher. So excellence can be subtle, right? You can say, I'm doing a great job. I get an 80% cure rate. I get 80% of my gross total resections in non-hormone. But the point is, you can do even better after you've done hundreds and hundreds of cases. And we shouldn't be complacent with just good when the possibility of better, you know, is in your future if you do more. My rate of lumbar drain use did go down over time. Procedure length didn't really go down over time. And maybe that's because I was training. Maybe that's because I was doing harder cases. For whatever reason, the length of the procedures was about the same. What's also as interesting is CSF leak. I would have thought that after 700 cases, my CSF leak rate would have gone down. And it did for some things, but on the whole, it really did not go down at all. And the reason I think is that once you have a successful algorithm for how to close the skull base, and once you're using a nasal septal flap and you're using the grafts, you're using whatever they are, whatever works for you, you know, it's not that technically difficult to do the closure. The hard part is knowing what to do rather than knowing how to do it. So once we had an algorithm that worked, it worked consistently, and it didn't really get that much better. Before I close, I just want to make a few comments about COVID, because I realized that working in New York City, we are at really the epicenter of this disease. It's become the place where COVID has really passed Lombardy, as you see in this second graph, with an enormous number of cases. And we've faced that at New York Presbyterian Hospital. And I just want to give you a sense of some of the numbers. So these is numbers over time. The first graph is total inpatients. And New York Presbyterian Hospital has like seven hospitals. It's not just one hospital. But there were 2,500 inpatients, of which the ICU, we had 750 patients in the ICU. And we had, at our peak, 750 patients intubated in the ICU. So imagine how many ventilator beds New York Presbyterian, and this doesn't count, you know, NYU. This is just Cornell, Columbia, Queens, Methodist, you know, a couple other smaller hospitals. So we had an enormous number of patients, and that number is now coming down, as you can see. New York Presbyterian had about 10,000 admissions and about 2,000 people who died of COVID. Really, you know, a bunch of very sick people. Now, there was a lot of fear about operating on a patient with COVID, and there was this question about what was going on in Wuhan and all these healthcare workers who had potentially gotten very sick, and then that was retracted in this article. But I think it's pretty clear that if you operate on a COVID positive patient, there's going to be a lot of aerosolization of virus, and you have to be super careful and take every precaution you can. And we have worked on, and other people are working on, these sort of negative pressure antichambers. I just want to give you a sense of, we're, you know, working on making this commercially available and covering that hole on the top with silicone. And this, I think, would be the safest way to operate on a patient who actually is COVID positive. We have not operated on a COVID positive patient because we test all our patients beforehand, and we only take them to surgery if they're negative. I haven't done anywhere it's been an emergency and I've had to do it knowing that they might be positive. So I haven't had that experience yet. So I just want to make a couple of concluding remarks. First of all, surgery for pituitary adenomas requires special expertise and experience. Ideally, it should be concentrated in the hands of centers of excellence. And I think I've shown that that gets better and better over time, even after hundreds and hundreds of cases. Finding the pseudocapsule and removing the tumor en bloc is the key to success. Extended approaches increase your extent of resection, but need to be performed by experienced surgeons or complications will ensue. Endoscopy increases your rate of gross total resection in large tumors, supracellular cavernous sinus tumors. Cavernous sinus exploration makes sense for soft, easily removable tumors to avoid a cranial neuropathy, since SRS is so effective. But if they're firm and fibrous, it can be very dangerous. Volume of 10 cubic centimeters lateral cavernous sinus invasion definitely lowers your extent of resection. Intraoperative MRI may not be that useful if one is skilled with endoscopy. If pituitary function is normal, 5% will deteriorate, and if abnormal, 8% will improve. Long-term recurrence rates are very, very low if you can get a gross total resection. And if you get a subtotal resection, it's okay to monitor your patient, withhold on SRS, unless you have a greater than a cubic centimeter of tumor or a Ki-67 greater than 3%. Reoperation is very effective strategy, you know, particularly in young patients. And the tail end of the learning curve for complex neurosurgical procedures is very long, and experience is constantly moving target. So those are my thoughts and the end of the talk. I wanted to leave some time for the panelists and discussion. Thank you very much.
Hey, Ted, that was a great talk. This is Rick here. Hey, Rick. I just had a question, two questions really. One was your use of fluorescein. I think some people do that, some people don't. Can you just comment a little bit about your experience using fluorescein? It sounds like you use it for every case.
No, absolutely.
And the benefit.
Yeah, no, so we don't. So we only would use fluorescein if for some reason we're going to be accessing the intrathecal space anyway, right? Okay, so when we started doing these cases, we would actually do lumbar punctures and inject fluorescein in all our patients. And over time, we've moved away from that. And because it's an extra procedure, patients can get headaches. We now use fluorescein only if we put a lumbar drain in. So if we're going to use a lumbar drain, which we use on all meningiomas, craniopharyngiomas, large chordomas, big intracranial cases, we'll use fluorescein because it's actually very useful during the operation to see the arachnoid planes during surgery. you know when you've breached the arachnoid, and at the end of the operation, you know you have a watertight closure because there's no fluorescein leakage, but we do not use it on every case. And really narrowed down the patients in whom we use it.
Got you. And then the other question that I had was, so you really focus upon that learning curve, which is absolutely critical. You know, we have the same experience here, and it's definitely helped us. But what do you recommend for people just starting out? I know that there's a lot of junior panelists here. Someone who comes out is well-trained, who's done a lot of pituitaries as a resident. How do you build a center of excellence as a junior attending interested in building it?
So, look, I think pituitary tumors are common, and you have to think about who's going to see them in their practice and which are the referring doctors you have to get to know, right? So neuro-ophthalmologists are one, endocrinologists are another, and even just medical doctors are another. So you want to find out who are the people who have those practices either affiliated with your hospital or in the community and reach out to them, maybe offer to give a talk or a luncheon seminar to them. And the cases will slowly come in, and the more you do, the better you'll get at them. It's important to have a good ENT colleague that you can work with, and do a lot of cases with that ENT colleague. It's good to, the more cases that you give to your ENT colleague, the more cases they will give to you, and the more used to working together you will get. There are some people who are good at doing it on their own for sure, but I think if you want to do advanced extended approaches, it's helpful to have a colleague, and I would very much recommend having a collaborator. And just, you know, obviously answer all your phone calls, you know, call people when they refer patients to you, you know, all the things that you learn about the three A's, affability, availability, that'll help you build your practice.
Great. All right. Thanks again, Ted. Great talk.
Yep. Thank you.
Ted, Jacques here. Fantastic talk. Really lots of very useful information. So tomorrow, Ted, I'm operating on a Cushing patient who has a completely normal MRI, a young woman who had petrosal sampling. Tell us a little bit, what's your approach with your endocrinologist to patients with Cushing, with completely normal MRI, and your use of inferior petrosal sampling, and what clinical outcomes should the patient expect when the MRI is completely normal?
Yeah. So those are some of the most difficult operations that we do, or challenging operations. You know, technically they can be very hard, but they're emotionally very challenging because we're used to, as surgeons, having a target to go after. Now, the inferior petrosal sinus sampling is not, as you know, always sensitive and specific. First of all, you have to make sure that it's done well. So you have to know how to evaluate your IPSS. And one of the things you have to look at is measure prolactin levels in addition to just cortisol levels, because you want to make sure that the catheters are in the right position and that your ratios are all appropriate. Because if you don't have the catheters in the right position for IPSS, then you're going to have falsely lateralizing information. So the first question I would ask you is, what did the IPSS show? How reliable do you think it was? When you discussed it with your endocrinologist, your interventional radiologist regarding the anatomy of the sinuses and all the sampling, was there lateralization, and did they feel confident about the lateralization?
Yes, we've got a nice system and very experienced endovascular people here, and one of them particularly tends to do all the petrosal sampling. Every point you said was done, the prolactin, and it's one of our UM endocrinologists taking care of the patient. So there is no doubt that with the clinical picture, this particular patient has pituitary origin Cushing. I mean, as you know, I mean, I don't know, I probably see 15 to 20% of the Cushings with normal pituitaries that, you know, you go on a kind of fishing expedition at surgery, the way Ed Laws described it. I was curious, you know, what's your take on those, right? And if you do a specific way.
What I was going to say is that if I'm confident of the lateralization, then I often remove that third of the gland on that side. I just take the whole thing out. And then I will explore the other parts of the gland by making incisions to see if I can find a tumor that may be missing. And if I find one, then it's great. And if I don't, at least I've removed the third of the gland, the entire third of the gland on the side where the IPSS lateralized the tumor, in the hope that the pathologist will find something small in there. Hopefully the pathologist gives you a result. Obviously you check your cortisol levels after surgery. You hope they plummet. And if they don't, you know, the imaging, re-imaging is not going to help you because you're not going to see anything you didn't see the first time.
Right.
You have to decide if you want to go back and, you know, re-explore, take out more of the gland. How much, you know, if you want to make them hypopituitary and take out all the gland, is it better to do it a bilateral adrenalectomy? Those are the decisions you have to make. But, you know, most of the time, if we've gotten good lateralization, I've removed that third of the gland completely. You can preserve their pituitary function and you can ideally cure them. And we've been successful a lot of the time. But it's very challenging. Thanks. Very difficult.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Great talk. There's about 40 questions in the Q&A, so I just want to get through maybe one or two of them, and then we have some cases I thought we'd go through with the panelists. One was talking about the other kind of fluorescence. I know there's some literature now looking at sodium fluorescein and 5-ALA, you know, to try to ensure that that gross total resection can be performed if you can't find the capsule. Is any opinions on that or any experience with that?
So we have a paper that's in revision that will soon hopefully be published in the Journal of Neurosurgery looking at 5-ALA for pituitary adenomas and other paracellular tumors. I did it with Gabe Zada, who you guys know from USC. So we found that essentially almost no pituitary tumors expressed 5-ALA when we used the PDD Storz ureteroscope, the one they use for bladder cancer. It's not really intended for endonasal surgery, but you can use it and look up there. We did not find it helpful at all for pituitary tumors. And the literature goes both ways on that. There's one report that says yes, one report that says no. But I used it and it did not help at all. Now, if I had had a very sensitive spectrophotometer, could there have been small amounts of 5-ALA in the gland, in the pituitary tumor? That's possible. But just using the normal blue light filter that we use on the Storz PDD scope, we did not see anything. The only tumor that we saw 5-ALA in was meningioma. I did an endonasal meningioma that lit up with the 5-ALA, and that's expected. About 80% of meningiomas we know light up with 5-ALA, so that's not a surprise. So I would not encourage people at this point to use a standard PDD Storz scope and 5-ALA. For meningiomas. Fluorescein, I don't think is that useful. The ICG that John Lee is doing, delayed, has more potential utility, and the folate receptor fluorescence that he has shown a certain percentage of the non-hormone producing tumors will have is much more useful because it's specific for pituitary tumors. But at this stage, we really don't have the fluorescence imaging, the right fluorescent dye that we need that works consistently on all of our pituitary tumors that allows us that level of confidence. But it'll happen. Time, it'll happen.
One other question was from the audience was, what's your threshold for pituitary tumors that enter the cavernous sinus for using intraoperative or cranial nerve monitoring for these lesions?
Yeah. So at our center, we don't use a lot of cranial nerve monitoring for the cavernous sinus. And that's just our particular preference. I tend to, for pituitary tumors, if they're soft and suckable, I'll go into the cavernous sinus. I'll try to take out as much as I can, but I will not be overly aggressive. It's a benign, slow-growing tumor, and there's no excuse for having a cranial neuropathy, in my opinion, when you're taking out a pituitary adenoma. They do respond to radiation therapy. And having a patient come out of the OR with a third nerve palsy or a sixth nerve palsy, which can be devastating for a benign, slow-growing tumor, in my opinion, just doesn't make sense. So if you're going to be so aggressive that you need to be using monitoring, you know, I think maybe you should double think that approach. Second guess, yeah.
And then just to answer a couple questions, just a little bit more about the closure. You know, the gasket seal, is that something that you kind of developed over time and found to be the best iteration? When do you supplement with that with fat in your cases?
So just to clarify, the gasket seal closure is something that we only use for craniopharyngiomas, meningiomas, and some chordomas, for big intradural tumors. We do not use a gasket seal closure for pituitary adenomas. Right now, our closure of choice for most pituitary tumors is actually an inlay of Allomax and a nasal septal flap if we have a big CSF leak, because I'm trying to avoid making any incisions on the patient's body if I don't have to. Fasciolata, I've had patients who come in, you take a big piece of fasciolata from their thigh, the muscle can actually herniate out through that big defect, and they can be very uncomfortable. So we've moved away from fasciolata entirely. And if we do a gasket seal, we actually use Allomax or Alloderm for the gasket seal. We just published an article showing that our CSF leak control was just as good. And the same is true of fat. We will sometimes use fat grafts, and I do find fat helpful from time to time, but if I don't think it's absolutely necessary, I'll try to avoid using a fat graft. So again, the gasket is very selective for expanded approaches that are intradural, intraarachnoidal tumors. You know, pituitary tumors are generally extraarachnoidal, and the CSF leak rates are much lower in pituitary tumors.
All right, thanks, Ted. We're gonna move on to some case presentations, maybe start with Pablo. Pablo, you wanna just do a case presentation, run it by Ted?
Sure, happy to.
Hey, Pablo.
Hey, Ted, good to see you virtually.
You too. Last time I saw Pablo, he was running on the Stairmaster next to me and running about 80 miles an hour, making me feel every year of my 55 years.
Well, so it's funny that you should say that, because I'm going to present a case on pituitary macroadenoma with cognitive changes. I did just want to wish Ted a happy birthday here. You know, Ted is he's a world man. You know, he's a talented musician, but he's also into falconry, as you can see here. And although he looks very young and spry, because every time I see him, he's in the gym, as he mentioned, there is no question that he is very much on his way to become the next most interesting man in the world. So happy birthday, Ted.
Pablo, thanks so much. I appreciate it.
So this case is just to highlight a few points and to get Ted's comments and see what he thinks. It's a 65-year-old, really 2 to 3 months of headaches and progressive confusion, gait instability, even urinary and fecal incontinence. And he was admitted to the hospital by his PCP. Family was wondering if he was starting to develop dementia. He's wide awake, conversant, but intermittently confused. He had very poor short-term recall, some scattered bitemporal defects on visual fields, had blurriness in his left eye for years, but that was just kind of left aside. And so here's what his MRI looked like. And so just wanted to see if we could get Ted's thoughts here. You know, it shows a big cellar mass expanding the cella itself, but with significant supracellar extension. We see the fornices being, you know, pushed, and in addition to that, his sinuses look kind of terrible, which is a little bit unrelated. Here's another view. We tend to get these KISS sequences, so there I'm pointing at the sinuses and kind of look not great. We can see that there doesn't seem to be any cavernous sinus invasion there, but then really significant supracellar extension and pushing on the fornices, which may explain his memory issues. So one question that I get asked sometimes is, you know, how high is too high, and when do you consider doing a craniotomy? And then also, you know, what about, in this case, what about this guy's sinus disease? So. Yeah.
Those are all great.
Do you have any thoughts there?
Yeah, sure. Those are great questions, great issues. So, you know, when I look at a tumor with supracellar extent like that, one of the questions is the tumor going back or is it going forward? And sometimes the tumors come very far forward over the planum. And this one is going back. And when I see the ones that are going back like this, I actually prefer to do an endonasal approach from the bottom, because the direction that the tumor is going is directly the entry site that you're going and the direction that you're going. So with an endonasal approach, you're going to be coming in along the long axis of the tumor, right? And that's really what you want to do. Now, there's a fairly narrow waist in the top of the cella at the diaphragma there, but you know, it's probably about a centimeter and a half. So once you take out the tumor that is in the cella, you know, you should be able to follow that straight up and decompress quite a bit of that. Now, do you have to take out every last bit of it? You may not, but the only other approach, obviously you can come in from above, but the fornices are gonna be draped over the top of the tumor. And that's the very anatomy that you're trying to preserve. And so, you know, there is some risk of damaging it that way. So, you know, it's funny that you mentioned the giant tumors that go forward. There was just one recently that came into our center, and I was recommending to the other surgeon who saw it that, you know, doing a craniotomy kind of made sense because you'd have to remove so much of the planum forward almost to the cribriform plate that it would really be, you know, a big approach from below. Doable, but, you know, risk of hemorrhage, not insignificant. The second question is the sinus question. And we have definitely operated on patients who have sinusitis and done it successfully. His sinuses look pretty bad. I would try to get a sense from your ENT whether he thought treating him with antibiotics for 2 weeks before surgery and steroids maybe might be able to decrease some of that inflammation because I really would prefer to come in through the nose if I could. And so I would do everything I could to try to sort of damper down the intensity of that infection inflammation before I proceeded with surgery, but I would try to do it endonasally.
Yeah, I think, you know, those are, I think, great, you know, great answers and similar, you know, we thought about that. We, since it wasn't emergent, we cooled them down a little bit with antibiotics. In addition to that, we also thought that given the angle that the tumor was going up, that it would be better attacked or more ideally attacked through an endonasal approach. I think one of the points that you touched upon is the bigger adenoma sometimes can be at risk for hemorrhage. This isn't one that we thought that we would necessarily leave a lot of residual disease if there would be, you know, residual disease. But I think it's an important thing to consider if you think that there's going to be a lot of residual disease. You know, sometimes people advocate of coming from above, you know, for that reason, you know, in case there's an apoplexy, which tends to happen in subtotally resected giant tumors. We went in nasally. I'm going to just, this is Bahat Adin and Hamid Borgay-Razavi, who helped with this video, who were here, but just a couple points here. We, Ted mentioned, we thought about actually taking a little bit of tuberculum, but we wanted to see how soft the tumor was. And this one happened to be soft and manageable with angled endoscopes. Here you can see we removed the cellar component and already are starting to work in that part that's going through the diaphragma, you know, posteriorly. And, you know, our intent was to hopefully get most of it. We didn't necessarily need to get all of it, particularly if, you know, if there is, you know, wanted to minimize traction on any manipulation of the fornices. But this was one which did lend itself to going in the nasally. As you can see, we did prepare for a high flow CSF leak, at least in my hands. I think this would be 100% high flow CSF leak. And here we can have a look there, you know, the decompressed, you know, fornices, thalamus, etc. And then we don't do the gasket seal. We actually tried this titanium clips that some of the Korean guys do to reapproximate the diaphragma to lessen the flow, and then did a multi-layer closure. But
beautiful. It's a beautiful case. That's great.
And then here's that result. But yeah, thanks for your thoughts there, Ted, in that case. And thank you, Mike, for the really kind invitation, as well as Rick and Jacques.
Great case. Thanks so much for that. Doug, do you want to go next?
Sure thing. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
All right. Let's see if I can share this. So thanks, guys, for having me here. I just have one case, the surgical details of which are not quite as interesting, but more consideration in the time of COVID, kind of how we manage some of these tumors, especially functional tumors. So I'm one of the, obviously, skull-based attendings at Ohio State. I should say the Ohio State, just down the road from Pablo. Hope things aren't too cold up there in Cleveland still. So this is a 33-year-old lady with weight gain and hypertension, and the diagnosis is not particularly in question here. You can see she has a high ACTH, a high random cortisol, elevated 24-hour urine cortisol, and classic suppression testing with Decadron, indicative of Cushing disease. And you can see, although this MRI is not the highest quality here, as well as a motion artifact, about 6 to 7 millimeter adenoma hypoenhancing right in the middle of the pituitary gland. So what looks like it should be a fairly straightforward case. The interesting thing about this is what happens next. So I saw her and we were planning on doing kind of semi-elective surgery about 2 or 3 weeks from then. We sent her to her preoperative imaging and anesthesia clearance, and she actually had a cardiac arrest in her public transportation in the bus and had the squad come whole and was on the news, incredible ordeal. And she had an anoxic injury from this. The etiology of her MI was felt to be uncontrolled hypertension secondary to her Cushing disease. And so she, again, coded in the ER, she was admitted to the MICU, she was there for many, many weeks. And eventually we were consulted again inpatient by the medical ICU team to talk more about her Cushing disease. And so this is 1 month post-code. She's still in the ICU. She has a tracheostomy and a PEG at this point. And you can see her MRI there showing this anoxic injury in the deep structures. She has kind of spontaneous movements. She's averbal. She has no interaction or tracking. And actually, before we even got reconsulted, they'd already talked to endocrine and our interventional radiologist, and she actually still has Cushing disease, and it was even IPSS proven at that point, since a repeat MRI at that time was a little bit hard to tell, harder to see that adenoma. And she still has Cushing disease very much. Her hypertension is still very much out of control, diabetes still out of whack. So the question that came to me, again, as a more junior faculty member, is now, what now? And I'd be very interested to see what the other panelists think about this. This is a patient who's very young, who has an anoxic brain injury with very kind of difficult to ascertain what her prognosis is going to be 1 year or 5 years down the road. And her family, who are very reasonable people, say, you know, if she's going to have any kind of neurological recovery, we want everything done. At the same time, we wouldn't want to, you know, have her undergo any unnecessary procedures if she's not going to have any kind of recovery. And so I would be interested in what you think, Dr. Schwartz, or anyone else about, you know, the role of surgery for this. Do you try medical therapy instead? Do you go to adrenalectomy, or do you say, do we do nothing in this?
You know, this, I don't think there's a absolute right answer here. I don't think this is a matter of, finding that one right answer. I think this is a complicated question that requires a lot of discussion. The first issue is to talk to the medical doctors and say, would this woman tolerate a transsphenoidal surgery? You know, what is her risk of having another cardiac arrest? Why exactly did she arrest? I wasn't sure I caught that on the presentation.
It was still a little unclear. She had an arrhythmia in the field. She did have a cardiac cath when she was admitted to the hospital, and it was actually clean. She didn't have any severe coronary artery disease. And she was monitored on telemetry basically the entire month she was in the hospital and had no further events.
Right. Severe Cushing's is eventually very life-threatening. And if you're trying to keep this woman alive to see if she recovers, leaving her Cushingoid is not a great option either and will definitely impair her ability to recover. And if the family wants to be aggressive, the medical therapies for Cushing's are not great. You left off radiosurgery, which is another option. I mean, you could blast the tumor. You see the tumor, right? So you could treat it with a high dose of stereotactic radiosurgery. It would be a non-invasive way to treat this with a cure rate that, you know, could be 30 to 50% or so. I'm not sure what the latest numbers are. It's certainly not first-line therapy, but in someone like this, it's something to consider. So I would I would talk to your radiosurgery colleagues about that and talk to the family about that as another option. You know, obviously adrenalectomy is not a first line therapy. So if you're gonna do something, I would either do stereotactic radiosurgery or transsphenoidal surgery based on her ability to tolerate the surgery and talking to the medical doctors with them, and then talking to the family about the rates of cure with SRS versus surgery.
One thing, did you guys chance consider, you know, in the medical therapy area, just even as a temporizing measure, for example, Korlym, which is essentially like a reversible adrenalectomy, you know, medically to deal with her Cushing symptoms and see if she recovered, and then perhaps make the, you know, punt it, you know, the decision definitively for down the line. I don't know, just a thought.
It was definitely brought up, absolutely. And we have used that even preoperatively for some of our very severe Cushingoid patients. People are basically medically unoptimizable, you know, for a preoperative event with pretty good success. It was brought up for this. So we had a long discussion for this, not to belabor the point. We talked with our chairman, we talked with ethics and the family and everything. And everyone agreed with proceeding for EEA surgery for a Cushing disease. With the thought that she could quite well tolerate this given her medical workup at this point. She had a very uneventful kind of boring, I would say, extracapsular resection. It was a textbook operation, nothing particularly unusual. I'll say this is the only patient I've ever operated on who had a tracheostomy that I was doing a microadenoma on. And her cortisol crashed to less than 5. I usually like to see them less than 2 afterwards, but I thought that given her overall kind of fragile state, the endocrinology wanted to start her on replacements once it hit 4 and not get another one. We usually monitor them every 6 hours. I was a bit pessimistic about this case, but I thought this was very reasonable, and it's certainly what the family wanted. And I was blown away when she came in a little bit over a year. So this was about a year ago that we did this, where she comes into clinic with now a normal BMI, her trach and peg are out, and her Cushing disease is in remission. So she has normal cortisol testing, and she's now verbal and oriented. So this isn't a self-aggrandizing story. I think it's an awesome outcome, but certainly it could have been done by anyone. I think the moral of this, and I kind of brought this case up in the era of COVID, is that in my mind and at our institution, you know, Cushing disease is really not a benign disease process. As Dr. Schwartz mentioned, the elevated mortality is not insignificant. And so I think we've always had the ability during the epidemic, during the pandemic, to operate on Cushing disease. We left that as an indication akin to cancer, basically, that we're still doing these operations as long as they're being COVID tested. I think it just brings up the point while we're kind of risk stratifying patients for operations while the health system is being stressed, that certainly Cushing disease should still be high on the list. So again, thank you guys for the invitation, and I really appreciate being here. And thanks, Dr. Schwartz. Happy birthday and a great talk.
I agree with that. You know, as an aside, it raises the question of acromegaly and how long it's safe to put off surgery on a patient with acromegaly. I have 4 patients who are waiting right now for surgery who have acromegaly, and I have to decide when to get them in. One of them is actually being pre-treated with medication to shrink her tumor, which is in the cavernous sinus. And, you know, I've found, and the literature is all over the place with pre-treating. But if you treat them too long, I think the tumors do get firm and fibrous and become difficult to remove. If you treat them for, you know, 1 to 3 months, not as much, and they do shrink a bit. And so she's on 3 months. So now she's getting to the point where if I keep treating her and putting off her operation, I could be undermining my ability to successfully take out her tumor. So I'm pushing to get her done. But, you know, acromegaly is not as deadly as Cushing's, but also does have negative effects on the body and the heart that increase over time. So it's debatable how long we should be able to wait for them. Any thoughts on acromegaly in the age of COVID?
It's a good question. At our institution, we considered all functional tumors the same, actually, and so we have done a few acromegaly. I'll say there have been a couple of patients, at least here, that chose to have their surgery delayed a couple of months, given everything going on. Right. Not everyone else's thoughts are.
Yeah, same at our institution, too. I think we were proceeding with the 2 tests for COVID before surgery, and if those are negative, then and the patient's okay, then we proceed with surgery. You know, the question is when the patient's COVID positive. You know, I think then really it would take something where they're having really severe symptoms to proceed rather than waiting the 4 to 5 weeks for them to pass their viral load. Okay, great. Wally or Simon, what do you guys have a case?
I can go ahead and present a quick case here. Dr. Schwartz, that was great. Happy birthday. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I'm working over at the Pacific Neuroscience Institute. Let me share this. With Dan Kelly and Garni Barkadarian as my partners. And now Dr. Neil Martin joined us over the last week. You guys see that there?
Yep.
Wonderful. So, colleagues.
Presentation. You're good.
So this is more of just a technique discussion. This actually happened last week. Our hospitals in Los Angeles have started to reopen elective cases. And this is something I was really trying to, as has been mentioned earlier, kick the can down the road as much as possible. Our patient, 62-year-old, history of anxiety, hyperlipidemia, who presented progressively worsening bitemporal headaches and increased fatigue.
Not seeing the slides there, Wally.
I'm sorry.
The title slide.
Sorry about technical difficulties. So 62-year-old female with progressively worsening headaches, subjective increased fatigue. On neurological examination, she was non-focal, and based on the imaging, I was a little surprised her visual fields were full. On neuro-ophthalmologic evaluation as well, her pituitary hormone function was normal at this time. Her ACTH was in the mid-40s. Here's the imaging, not subtle, but we see the normal pituitary gland, very large, destructive, heterogeneously enhancing lesion, compressing the pituitary gland posteriorly. Tumor was invading into the nasopharynx through the sphenoid ostium as well, and pushing the A2s over posteriorly and to the left. This was just to show you the destruction of the clivus as well, involved in the tumor. So ultimately, after months of following her and doing the imaging, we decided to move forward with surgery. Once the elective surgeries opened up, her headaches were continuing to worsen. It was a giant macroadenoma, non-functional, as I presumed. We did the two negative COVID testings and the negative chest CT. And of course, she was asymptomatic as well. At the Pacific Neuroscience Institute, with Dr. Kelly, Dr. Barkadarian, and our ENT colleagues, we have our method of endonasal surgery. Since this case was last week, I didn't get the video together in time, but this is a very similar case of a supercellular cranial. I initially, as Pablo mentioned, try to do this case endonasally transcellar without having to do an extended case. We raise our nasal set the rescue flaps in preparation for a possible nasal septal flap. And for the sake of time, I'll speed up here. Ultimately, I could not get the supercellular portion of the tumor down. And because of the heterogeneity and the firm consistency of the tumor, so I had to expand to go transplanum, open up the tuberculum, and we were able to pull the tumor down. Of course, we had the large defect. And at the end of the procedure, I know the closures are different, and I'm very interested that Dr. Schwartz has moved more away from normal fat grafts. We are actually very fat forward at our shop. In my case, I think I might have gone a little heavy here. But we typically do the fat graft into the cella and into the early portion of the supercellar region with a collagen sponge and a bony flap in between. We raise the nasal septal flap and then add additional fat there and the second piece of collagen to sort of bolster the closure. So this is similar to what things look like after surgery. Post-operatively, overall, I was happy. This is the extension of the post-operative CT scan. Don't see any obvious evidence of tumor here. I was a little bit worried that I didn't see the bright, consistent enhancement of the nasal septal flap. And the other question is, how much fat is too much? When we're putting it in, I try to just pack off the defect. I think this is a little bit heavy-handed compared to what we usually do. But post-operatively, her pain was well-controlled. Thankfully, her visual fields were full to confrontation. Her post-operative ACTH and cortisol were normal. ACTH actually came down to 22. No evidence of DI. She was discharged later on post-operative day one. Her mirror cell packing that we used to bolster the closure was done today. And the flap, per my ENT, who was texting me during this talk, actually looks quite good. Pathology came back, sparsely granular corticotroph pituitary adenoma. That ACTH coming down, we'll continue to follow up with endocrinology and follow up with imaging in terms of future care. The main discussion points I had, you know, prior to my ENT colleague actually taking a look at the flap today, when you don't see that brightness on the nasal septal flap, are you prepared to do anything additional there? Or because of the general lower risk with the macroadenomas of leakage, you just watch it and let it present itself?
Yeah, we definitely do not act just based on imaging of the flap. I don't think that's enough to motivate a reoperation unless there's a CSF leak. But the main difference in my opinion would be that use of fat. You know, we moved away from use of fat for a couple of reasons. One reason was that you have to make another incision in the patient's abdomen. If you could have a zero or just as low a CSF leak without a second incision, I'm sure we would all prefer that. We're trying to do minimally invasive surgery. We're trying to avoid cutting into our patients and any sort of discomfort, violating their body in any way. And so fat certainly does that. Post-op imaging with a huge hunk of fat in there can be difficult to interpret. And so you can get fat suppressed MRI, but sometimes they get outside imaging and they don't know to do a fat suppressed MRI. And then you see that big hunk of fat in there and it's very hard to see if there's a little bit of residual tumor growing next to that fat. So it does impair your post-operative imaging. Also, you have a lot of fat in the sphenoid sinus. And, you know, my ENT colleagues say they don't love going back and sucking out all that fat. It becomes necrotic in the nose. The patient can have a foul smell in their nose from necrosing fat. So we try to use fat sparingly on the closure. With respect to the graft, there's some people who advocate a non-vascularized flap. And you can use a free mucosal flap. Obviously, if you have a patient who's going for radiation or you have a severe CSF leak, vascularized flap is better and will heal more quickly, but it's not required or essential, and that flap can still sometimes survive getting its blood supply from adjacent mucosa. So I advocate waiting and re-imaging. But if you don't have a CSF leak, I think it's irrelevant what the flap looks like. And if it comes necrotic, it may need to be debrided by the ENT in the office at some later time, but hopefully by then everything else will have fibrosed in and the fat, I guess, that you put in there will have prevented the leak.
What's your usual post-operative for these non-functional tumors, post-operative lab follow-up immediately?
So they follow up with the ENT surgeon, 1 week, 3 weeks, 6 weeks, 3 months. I see them at 3 months is the first time I usually see them because most of their issues in the short run are related to ENT. And then, of course, we fluid restrict them from post-op day 4 to post-op day 7, get a cortisol and a sodium level on post-op day 6 to make sure they don't have any hyponatremia. And if they do, obviously become more aggressive with our management of that because there's a rate of about 7% delayed hyponatremia. And then we image them at 3 months, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 5 year, 7 year, 10 year. That's kind of the general algorithm for non-hormone producing tumors.
I've heard a lot of different things from a lot of the colleagues and some panelists here. Do you do anything while they're immediately post-op day 0, post-op day 1 in the hospital?
With respect to what?
The hormone function separate from DI.
You know, we don't give them any steroids. We check a fasting AM cortisol post-op day one, post-op day two. If it's normal post-op day two, we let them go. We tend not to let our patients go post-op day one. We just get a ton of phone calls and we keep them one extra day. And if the cortisol is low post-op day two, we'll replace them and just have the endocrinologist taper them as an outpatient. And then we check the, sodium probably Q, I think it should be maybe Q12 for the first 24 hours. I think our residents do Q6, but I tell them they don't have to do it that often, make sure it's okay. But you do want to check it a little more frequently in the first day just to make sure they're not going into DI. And then try to take their Foley out, send them home post-op day two.
Thank you, Greg.
I think we only have just a few minutes left. Maybe Dr. Hanft, if you have one last case or maybe two cases, if Martin has one too. Oh, perfect. I think you're muted, maybe.
Are you guys seeing the screen?
Yeah, we can see the screen now.
Yeah, this is a little bit of a bare bones presentation compared to the others, but I'll just give you the quick background. This is a young patient, 27 years old, who originally presented around 2 years ago with significant visual loss, and that's what led to cranial imaging, where a large tumor was found. And his prolactin level at the time was over 6,000. So he was started on cabergoline, did not get neurosurgical evaluation at the time, and was kind of intermittently compliant with the cabergoline. And due to compliance issues and also insurance issues, he basically abandoned the cabergoline. And over a relatively short period of months, his visual loss became more profound and he got this MRI and the prolactin level was basically back to where it had been a couple of years ago, if not a little bit higher in the 6,000-7,000 range. Considering kind of what the MRI shows and that little bit of background, an initial interesting question is just, what would you do in this case? Would you advocate for the cabergoline? Would you do surgery to decompress because it's just such a dramatically large tumor and his visual loss is profound and has gotten worse recently?
Yeah, I mean, obviously you want to try to treat it with cabergoline. There's no question, but the patient is non-compliant. You tell the patient, look, you're going to go blind and we're going to have to do surgery on you if you don't take your medication. If they still don't take the medication and go blind, I don't think you can keep trying to push it. I think at some point, you don't want to let them go blind. So I think you have to do surgery in this situation. The question is, what's the best approach? So, if you ask me, could you take this out endonasally? I would say, yes, you probably could. You may even be able to get all of it out, but I'm not sure. But I would be very worried about a post-op hematoma in a case like this, because it's going to be nearly impossible to see all of that cavity from the inside and get adequate hemostasis and have a low enough risk of post-op hematoma that you're not going to have to come back and do something else. So honestly, I would probably do a cranio-orbital approach on the right side. I'd take out the orbital rim because you're going to have to go pretty high up here and try to come low, could you do it through an eyebrow? Maybe you could, but I'm not sure with such a big tumor, you need to be so sort of slick and small, So I think I'd probably do a cranial orbital approach, honestly.
Yeah. I actually ran this by Brad and Rick, a couple of panelists here, and ultimately did almost exactly what you said. I think because of the non-compliance with the cabergoline, the acuity of the visual loss, his youth and otherwise his health, I think, we opted for upfront surgery here. I didn't get too fancy with the craniotomy. I basically just did, fairly boilerplate perioral. We were able to basically get that entire supracellar component out. It wasn't that easy, It was very much up against the optics, as you'd expect, and required a lot of dissection there. But he had visual improvement after the surgery, which was great. And then you have that cellar component there. This is not maybe the greatest image His prolactin level came down dramatically. It came down to, I think, 180 or something like that. What would you do for that kind of residual there? Would you treat it? Is the number low enough so you're not that concerned? Would you go in endoscopically? Would you just follow it? How would you handle that, just that cellar component that's left with the prolactin of 180?
Yeah, you know, so as I said in my talk, so let me ask you a question. What was the Ki-67, do you know, of the tumor? How rapid?
It actually wasn't that high. I don't remember it exactly, but I can't tell you if it was above or below 3%, but I think it was below.
Yeah, I would be worried based on the size that this achieved, right? You have to say this is probably a pretty rapidly growing tumor. This is not your average pituitary tumor to get that big. So I would be worried this would grow back. It looks like it's invaded the cavernous sinus. Given what you're telling me, you know, could you go in endonasally and debulk the cellar part? Yes, but would you get all of it out? You know, you probably not. It looks like a NOSP4 on the right side. So I might go right there and send him for radiation, unless the radiation oncologists say that it's too close to the optic nerves and you have to get it farther away. But I think it's big enough that you could do fractionated radiation, not damage the optic nerves, and decrease the risk of recurrence. But given the size of the tumor, I would be worried that he's not going to take his cabergoline. There's no reason he's going to take it now if he didn't take it before when he was going blind. Right. And your surgery, if you're not going to get a gross total resection and cure him, given how big this grew, it's probably going to grow back. I would just send him for fractionated radiation now.
Yeah, no, I think that's actually the route that we ultimately recommended. So he may have had a little bit of a come to Jesus moment after this, and we felt that with him, his mother, who became very involved with the case, and also his endocrinologist, that interestingly, he might have been more compliant with the cabergoline. I just did this operation like 4 or 5 months ago, so we're just going to see kind of how that unfolds, and if not, then we'll bring him in for treatment.
Sounds good. Great. It's a beautiful case. Great job.
Okay, thanks, Simon. And maybe if Martin, you could get your case in less than like 1 or 2 minutes. And I know Dr. Schwartz probably has some birthday celebration going on this evening, and we want to let him go.
This is it. This is pretty
much. Sure, guys, I'm happy to keep it quick, and thank you again for the invitation. Can you guys see the screen?
Not yet.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see if this works better. No luck there. Let's see.
We see you.
Not yet.
Beautiful painting on your wall. Who is that?
here, Martin, let me just share. I have your talk, so let me just share it for you.
Sorry about that, guys. Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, here you go.
So I was sort of joking. Again, happy birthday, Dr. Schwartz. This patient actually just showed up the day before yesterday, so I think that she knew you were giving a talk soon. So very much appreciate any input you have here. But just to keep it quick, it's a 65-year-old female who came in with basically a code stroke-like symptoms. She had worsening confusion and lethargy, was very hypothermic, had low glucose, came in with a probable UTI, just had a very, very poor exam. Really was only intermittently cooperative with exam. And her husband basically told us that she was completely normal 3 days prior, was a big texter, vision was normal, carried out all of her activities of daily living. And let's see, Mike, if we could go to the next slide. She had, you know, signs of hypopituitarism as would be expected, and she came in with this scan. So pretty massive tumors you can see here, you know, multiple compartments. And I think the big question here for you is again, sort of Pablo's question, which is how high is too high? And then the second sort of clinical question was, how often you see sort of cognitive issues and sort of, what kind of improvement you see oftentimes when you take out these tumors with these patients who really come in with decreased cognition, you know, memory issues, really, really poor exams, and what your experience has been there?
I think this is a good endonasal case. It's heading backwards. The diaphragm is not that tight. You work it in compartments. You kind of go to one area, you go to another area. You know, one part of a tumor is a corridor to another part of the tumor. There's part of the tumor that's pushing back on the mammillary bodies, and some of it pushing up on the fornices. All of that could be causing her memory problems. And so, you know, she may get significantly better. You know, it's not the frontal lobe compression that's causing a memory issue. She's also, you know, so grossly panhypopit. It's unclear how that's contributing. And she's going to need replacement. It's unlikely, as I mentioned in my talk, that those hormone, that hormone production is going to get better. So she needs everything replaced. And then I think it's hard to know. It's probably more based on age. You know, I think if you, if she's young enough and you get the whole tumor out or majority, you decompress the fornices and the PAPE circuit and the mammillary bodies, I think her memory could improve quite a bit, get her metabolism up, you know, and her cortisol up. You know, if she's very elderly and frail, then, you know, it may not improve as much as you'd hope for. But in terms of how high is too high, this is definitely not too high. And I think you'll have a, should have a good result endonasally, and, you know, maybe take off a little bit of the tuberculum there and, you know, just dig down into the clivus.
And let's say you were to try this endonasally, it was a firm tumor, you know, you had a supracellar residual. How long do you typically wait between your first stage endonasal and your second stage transcranial approach?
Well, you know, it's in terms of firm, you know, usually you can, I like to use the Nico Myriad. I have no interest in the company, but it's nice for very firm tumors. So if you have access to that tool, you know, I ask for it in tumors like this, that it's available in the room in case they are firm. If there's a supracellar component and there's no visual loss, then I think you can wait, you know, 2 to 3 months and see what happens. If there's visual loss, then I would go in pretty quickly. If it's just supracellar, you could probably do a little eyebrow incision and get the rest out based on the frontal sinuses and how big they are. And if there's no visual loss and it starts to descend, then you could, honestly, you could follow it, or, you know, if you want to take it out electively at some later time, you could.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
All right, great. Any other comments from the panelists? Otherwise, I think we've had a long enough birthday celebration with Dr. Schwartz.
Wait, Brad has to sing me happy birthday.
Oh, okay. You got enough candles there then?
I do.
Okay.
I'm waiting.
Happy birthday to you. I don't want to, I see those participant numbers dropping with my singing.
Exactly. Stop. It's enough. It's good. It's good. Stop. All right. Thanks, guys. I really appreciate it. It was a lot of fun.
Thank you so much. Thanks to all the panelists. Thanks.
Yeah, everybody. This is fantastic.
We'll see you next week.
Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Ted. Awesome talk.
Thank you, Ted. That was great. Happy birthday. Mm-hmm.